And I appreciate you working with us today. And I hate it to happen on Chad's first time. I mean, to bring the worship, but awesome time. Yeah. I mean, no, it's not about a projector. It's not about, it's all about Jesus. And actually, I'm going to go ahead and tell you, there was no projectors when Jesus was doing the teaching. Okay. There was no microphones, no nothing. I'm going to go ahead and shock you now. So, I mean, no, he got his point across. So, what we're going to do this morning is, we're going to go ahead and do our tithes and offering. And then, Debbie, you're going to have your, is he going to be set up? And then I'm going to come and talk about his trip to Sturgis, where he went and did some ministry on the bike. And I'm always loving to see what God's got to do whenever Dano goes on some of these motorcycle trips and ministry, and just an awesome time. So, but we're going to go ahead and take up our tithes and offering this morning. So we got the offering confession up. And anybody been blessed?
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Can I be honest with you? What's going on this morning goes, for some reason, it goes along with what I'm teaching on. So. What? What? What is it? What did I say wrong? So, anybody been blessed that you want to lead us in the offering confession this morning? Man, y'all are not a blessed people. What am I going to do with you? Yeah, Kevin said he will. Yeah, I was at Carolina the other day, and I'm doing something, and I threw a penny out just to see if I was going to pick it up. Nobody ever picked it up. I'm like, man. Nobody even picked up a penny. That's picking more than what they would have had. So I'd have picked it up. I should have went back to God. I don't know why. Right?
Jesus Christ is Lord. Apart from Him, we have no good thing. Right? Amen. Let's go. As we receive today's offering, we believe the Lord for jobs and better jobs, praises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, and faithful settlements, estates and inheritance, and interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts of surprise, finding money, debts paid off, expenses decreased, blessings can decrease. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all my financial needs that I have made more than enough to give to the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah. What we do here, we bring the offering to the front. We have the message on the end, the tithe, an endless fund just to help out with any needs in the church, with any families with power, utilities. So come, and as you give somebody a good handshake, a good hug, and welcome here. If you haven't met them yet, some of our visitors here, meet them. And the children be dismissed at this time too.
Thank you.
go out, we go out to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And hey, Mary, long time to see you. And the thing is, that's what it's all about. It's all about Jesus Christ. We're going to share a video first, and then I'll talk more about it. It's going to be on this the back wall here. And if some of you are wondering, why don't we just turn it around shining up there? It's because that projector, you have to put it right here on the front in order for it to show on the screen. So that's why we're showing it back there instead of up here at the main one, bro. All right, whenever we're ready, set, go. These are just some highlights here, some of the places we've seen, some of the says, hey, girls walk.
I'm like, okay, so you said we're in the World Series, and I'm batting, and you'd rather me not take a walk. You'd rather me strike out than take a walk. That's what I'm thinking. And this was years ago, so it wasn't a thing against the women. That's just the way they you know, said it. So it wasn't. At that point, girls didn't play Little League Baseball. I think, you know, they hadn't been there. So I'm not down in women. Okay, I'm just pretty much, he told me. So don't get mad at me, okay? I want to stay safe on this. But that was my major league experience. Trying out for the Cincinnati Reds, making a complete idiot out of myself. Which I do, I still do continually, making an idiot out of myself. But we have Bryce Harper here making $330 million over 13 years. We got millions of people who buy lottery tickets every week hoping to hit that winning number that will make them a millionaire. And that's going to make them happy. Figuring that's going to financially set them up for the rest of their life. Let me tell you, I never bought a lottery ticket. I got to be honest. I did the Reader Digest stuff. All right? Every time that sweepstake came out, I went in there and I filled out everything in there, put the sticker where they're supposed to go, put it in the envelope, put everything and send that off. And every time I did it, I said, okay, God, here's your opportunity to bless me. I did. Guess what? I never got blessed. But I am working on my second meeting. Never got the first, I'm working on the second. So, hey, no. We all want to be that millionaire, don't we? We all want. I mean, no, you can't build your foundation on money. I want to read a little something that Max Lucado wrote. I'm going to be Lucado or Lucado. Lucado, thought it was right. He said, hot sun, salty air, rhythmic waves. A little boy is on a beach. On his knees, he scoops and packs the sand with plastic shovels into a bright red bucket. Then he upends the bucket on the surface and lifts it up. And to the delight of the little architect, a castle tower is created. All afternoon, he will work, spooning out the moat, hacking the walls. Bottle tops will be the sentries. Popsicles will be bridges, and a sand castle will be built. Then you have big city, busy streets, rumbling traffic. A man is in his office. At his desk, he shuffles papers into stacks and delegates assignments. He cradles the phone and punches the keyboard with his fingers. Numbers are juggled and contracts are signed, and much to the delight of the man, a profit is made. All of his life, he will work, formulating the plans. Forecasting the future. Annuities will be centuries. Capital gains will be bridges. And an empire will be built. Two towers and two castles. They have much in common. They shape values into renders. They seek nothing and make something. They are diligent and determined. And for both, the tide will rise and the end will come. Yet, that is where the similarities cease. For the boy sees the end while the man ignores it. Watch the boy as the dust approaches. Each wave slaps an inch closer to his creation. Every crest crashes closer than the one before. But the boy doesn't panic. He's not surprised. All day the pounding waves are reminding him that the end is going to happen. He knows the secret of the surging. Soon they will come and take his castle into the deep. The man, however, doesn't know the secret. He should. He's like the boy. Lives surrounded by the rhythmic reminders. Days come and go, seasons ebb and flow. Every sunrise will become a sunset. Whispers the secret. Time will take your castles. So, one is prepared and one isn't. One is peaceful while the other panics. As the waves near, the wise child jumps to his feet and begins to clap. There is no sorrow, no fear, no regret. He knew this would happen. He's not surprised. And when the great breaker crashes into his castle and his masterpiece is sucked into the sea, he smiles. He smiles, picks up his tools, takes his father's hand, and he goes home. The grown-up, however, is not so wise. As the waves of years collapse on his castle, he is terrified. He hovers over the sandy monument to protect it. He blocks the waves from the walls he has made. Salt water soaked and shivering, he snarls at the incoming tide. It's my castle, he defies. The ocean need not respond. Both know to whom the sand belongs. Finding the cliff, the water mounts high above the man and his little empire. For just a moment, he's shadowed by the wall of water. Then it crashes. His tiny tower of triumph crumbled, dispersed, and he is left on his knees, clutching muddy handfuls of yesterday. If only he had known. If only he had listened. If only, but he, like most, never listens. You know, as I read that, I began to see more of the picture of this wise builder and the foolish builders. And here in Matthew 7, Jesus is describing people like this man. He said that they are unprepared by saying they know nothing about what will happen. Some may think that Jesus is just talking about the lost, but maybe not. I think there are many Christians, kind of like this man that Max Licato talks about. I mean, they aren't rebellious. They aren't angry at God. The problem is, they become blind. They can't see the sun setting. They can't hear the pounding waves. You know, during the last week of Jesus' life, he took some time to tell the people to prepare for the end. In Matthew 24:36, but at that day and hour, no one knew, not even the angels in heaven, but my Father only. And I think this message that he gives is unmistakable. Jesus will return, and no one knows when. You can read all the books you want to. You can read 88 reasons why he's coming back. Guess what? In 88, he didn't come back. You can read all you want. And I've said it before. If God had not told Jesus, why would he tell you? That's my thinking on that. So we know that he's going to return. So what he's telling us is to be ready. Now the question is, are you ready? Are you ready for the return of Jesus? I said this, I heard this long ago. If Christians really knew that Jesus would come back tomorrow, would they be living different today? They'd be a totally different. So we just kind of put it out there. I mean, we're not promised tomorrow. And so Jesus gave us three parables to illustrate the message in Matthew 25. He gave us the parables of the virgins. He gave us the parable of the talents. He gave us the parable of the sheep and the goats. Church, I believe with all my heart, we have got to begin to take attention to this message from Jesus. I believe that it's a message that we cannot ignore. How many Christians treat this world like it's their permanent home? They believe they're saved. They believe in the coming back of Jesus. They believe in eternal life. And they will be living with Jesus, yet they live as if this is their eternal life. This world. You know, I'm guilty. We pour our time, we pour our energy into a life that is going to last forever. That's what we think. This life will not last forever here on this earth. Ecclesiastes 2:18, Solomon said, "Yet I hated all my labor, in which I had toiled under the sun, because I must leave it to the man who will come after me." One day, Gene and I are going to die. And everything we have goes for our children, our grandchildren, and who knows, sometime great-grandchildren. We're not going to be able to take everything with us. I can't pack my house. I can't pack my truck. Matthew 6:20, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. Listen, it is not a sin to have money. It's not a sin to live in nice houses. It's not a sin to drive nice cars. It's not a sin to have all those good things. The problem is when we make those things our priority, that's where we get in trouble. And I'm saying it more and more. Remember the story of the three little pigs? The first pig built his house out of straw with no structure, and the wolf comes and he huffs and he puffs and he blows the house down. The second little pig builds his house out of sticks with no structure. The wolf comes along. He huffs and he puffs and he blows the house down. And so these two little pigs run to their older brother, which is probably just a few minutes older, okay? And the third pig had built his house on bricks and mortar with structure. And when the wolf comes, he huffs and he puffs, but he doesn't blow the house down. He huffs and he puffs, and he doesn't blow the house down. He was unable to blow it down. And so the three little pigs were safe, and they were not eaten. So many people have a problem with their foundation today, I believe. And I think the strength of your house depends on its foundation. Church, we are God's structure. The foundation of our structure has to be Jesus Christ. That this is the only way to be a great temple for the kingdom of God, is to be that structure that has the foundation of Jesus. If I'm the temple of the Holy Spirit dwells in me, Jesus dwells in me, I want to have, and he's my foundation. Then guess what? I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. I have Jesus in me. He is my foundation. I have a strong structure. And it saddens me because I've seen day after day, and I'm reading this, reading that, where people's structures are messing up because their foundation is no longer Jesus. I look back and I think young people that were in my youth ministry years ago, that they had walked away from Jesus. I knew they had a foundation, but they have turned. You know, in Matthew 7, it talks about false prophets. Let me tell you who our false prophets are today. Our false prophets of the day are the voices of our society. Entertainment, social media, those things are our false prophets. It ain't preachers on the corner. It ain't. It's what we're listening to, and they're taking our young people and they're pulling them away. It saddens me to read things on Facebook that I'm reading from, I know, true Christians that have been serving God. And now they're talking against the church. They're talking against Christians because they were hurt. And I know their foundation is on Jesus, but then they begin to listen to these false prophets. I'm reading where Joshua Harris, a big mega church pastor, I think, denounced his belief, his faith. A songwriter from United, Elevation United, just denounced their faith. How can you denounce your faith in somebody you have believed for and you believed in for so many years? It's because they've listened to the false prophets. They've listened to the voices of the society that says, hey, there's another way to heaven. You don't have to go through Jesus. You can make it a different way. You can do this, you can do that. They're listening to them instead of listening and reading the Word of God. And then you got churches that won't preach the Word. can't use bad material things in building our home. The quality of your materials will determine the strength of your structure. Are you building it on the Word of God? How much effort are you willing to put into your structure? Are you going to give God 1 hour of every day? Or are you going to give God 24 hours of every day? Are you going to give God 1 day a week? Or are you going to give God 7 days a week? I believe we have a problem today. It's called the wolf, and the wolf is coming against the church today. And Christians are either being blown away or being eaten. And you need to know that the devil is 100% committed to taking you out. Where's the location of your faith? The pigs, faith were in their chin hairs. They said, not by the chin, our chin, chin, chin. Okay? Is your faith in your material things? Or is your faith in Jesus? Because Jesus said, follow me. And follow me. He said this because he knew that all of us are following someone or something. And in Matthew 7:15, he gave us that stern warning about false prophets. How they come in sheep clothing, but they're really wolves. These false prophets that are the voice of society, entertainment, political world, social media. You know, you get these things on Facebook, if you're on Facebook or something, you get these things on Facebook, and when they send it, it's filled with garbage about this or that. And you kind of glance over it, but then next thing you know, you haven't read the whole thing, and it just made you angry, and you just all of a sudden, you took it, and you passed it to other 50 people. Because if you didn't pass it to other 50 people, you were going to have a curse on you. Okay? Something bad was going to happen to you if you didn't pass this along. And I have been guilty of passing that along without ever reading it. That's called, what's the word? Stupidity. Okay. Because it's stupid to do that. I need to read it because there might be something in there that's totally talking against God. And I got to apologize to a brother right here. Brother Frank, he was post on every day that he sent it to us. I have been guilty of being in a hurry and just glancing over it and then just saying, look, I'm going to get a check mark. Good. I won't read them things, brother. I'll never do that again. But God dealt with me on that. That's why I can bring that up. We should take responsibility to read it. Yeah. Thing, you just don't take that and look at the first line and say, okay, I'm going to send this off. It sounds good. Then you go on down and then they have this other stuff that nobody needs to read. Church, what is happening to our temple today? What is happening to our temple today? And y'all mind if I really get real here this morning? We just had a vacation public school. Loving having all these children. Loving having the children. But the only thing that broke my heart is that for the last night when I had them all up here, I never saw the worship. Maybe I'm wrong, but I never saw the worship that these kids should be in. And they ain't all called the vacation Bible, so it ain't forgotten. The fault lies with the parents. And I'm going to get real. And I'm not get real. This is nothing against Corey. Okay? Nothing against the fact. I love the fact. I love the fact of the children. here is my banners. Right here are my flags. And if I can't do it with these first, if I put something in my hand, is that all I can make it to worship? No. No. Because I've seen it. And we're bringing our children in here now to worship. Let me tell you, we had some faults with the projector. Should that have discouraged our worship? How many entered into worship? And there's great worship songs. But because we had a change, oh my goodness, we don't have a projector. And we had to turn around and look at the wall. The worship is not on the wall, the worship is in here. Amen. This is the empty room, the worst that you can, but there still should be worship in here. We train our kids in that way. All the kids come here. All the kids just came in and just come here and sit on the altar. Y'all come here and sit up here.
Did you want the nursery also?
That's okay. We'll just do with it. Your structure. You need to face more deeply and deeply. here that some of the foundation of the pool part of the building was wrong. And they had to close it down, and they didn't fix it up. Then they came back. And all it took, I think, was a half or three quarters of a difference in that foundation. And they closed it down and said, you can't stay in that foundation. You can't stay in that building. Because the foundation is not what it's supposed to be. So now they're having to go back and refix that foundation. I'm here to tell you, it's not too late to fix your foundation. It's not too late for your structure to get back to where it needs to be. That you're not leaning, but you're straight up with God. That when I stand before God, I am straight up. And I worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, my Savior. And these kids need to see it. We got just a few minutes. I don't know. I have prayed and said, Lord, I don't know. But listen, I don't want to put nobody in condemnation. I just want the Holy Spirit to convict. But the more and more that I read, the more and more we talk about it together. Is the church relevant today?
Spirit.
we need to be the example for these kids as they're growing up. And before we leave, I just want to ask, is there anybody here this morning? You're saying, Pastor, my structure has gotten weak because of kind of neglected God. And this morning, as you spoke, as this morning, as I've heard that I want to have my structure on rock. I don't want the sand to come along and wash me away. I want to stand strong in your structure. I want to stand strong in you, Jesus. I want you to be my foundation. Maybe you've never asked Jesus Christ into your heart. This morning, I'm going to give you an opportunity. Is anybody here this morning? You never asked Jesus into your heart. Alright? Anybody here, you feel like your structure has got a weak? And you just want us to lift you up and say, I want to get my structure back strong. Anybody in here? Alright? Praise God. Then let's be the church that God's called us to be. And before we leave this morning, and be safe. Haven't heard anything from Kevin.